So back here with Patrick Timms, Deputy Editor of the Wolves of Westminster blog. And we're going to move away from Westminster to go to Holyrood and the Scottish government. There's a new power sharing deal between the SNP and the Greens. That's the first time the Greens have been in power anywhere in the UK. What does it mean for Scotland, do you think, Patrick?
Well, yes, I gather they're going to get a couple of junior ministers appointed as part of the deal. But it looks as though, you know, they are pro-independence, just like the SNP, and they are on board with a lot of the SNP's policies, but not all of them. So we're yet to see exactly how that's going to work out in terms of the Scottish government. With that said, though, obviously, you know, you've signed a coalition deal. The last major one in this country had the Conservatives and the Lib Dems, and they certainly didn't agree on everything. So, you know, some people, when they see these situations, they like to say, oh yes, but they don't agree on everything. Well, of course they don't. If they did, they'd be in the same party, wouldn't they? It wouldn't be a coalition. But it looks as though they've made enough progress in talks with each other to form a majority government.
Yeah. It's a bit unfortunate for the SNP. They were just short of a majority. So they'd probably be a bit frustrated that they've had to do this, because it kind of weakens their plans for a next independence referendum, because they've got to negotiate one other party, an additional party now. And they're going to have their own ideas, the Greens, about what independence looks like. And they're going to want to say in that, aren't they? And it's not going to, the SNP aren't going to have it their own way when it comes to, if there is another referendum, which I think is some years off, but if this agreement's still in place, it's going to be more difficult for them to kind of form a platform on which to campaign.
Well, that's true. And of course, if you look at the past 5 years of Scottish politics, it was an SNP minority government, and they relied on the Greens in order to pass a budget, but they were still a minority. So for them, I suppose, for the SNP, for Nicola Sturgeon, this is progress, because now they officially have a coalition that has a majority. For in the past session, they didn't.
Yeah, exactly. They've lost the momentum, haven't they, the SNP, with the independence debate. I do read the Scottish newspapers, Scottish Herald, and Scotsman, and the National, and I see that a lot of the wind's gone out of their sails. So if they are going to start a new campaign to get another referendum, it's going to be not starting from, square one, but they're going to be starting from a lower point in the political cycle than they would have been if they'd launched a campaign straight after the May election, because that seems like a long time away now, doesn't it?
It does, and of course we've also seen the lifting of restrictions in most of the country since then. It's difficult to speculate on these things, isn't it? I don't know the mind of the First Minister, but if I were Nicola Sturgeon, I think I'd be thinking, leave it till next year and have a go from then, you know, and leave it till after Christmas. And she may well do exactly that, because although it'll be 2022, we may have an election as soon as the year after general election, UK general election, as soon as the year after that. It's not supposed to be for 2 years after that, but many people in Westminster have been speculating that the Prime Minister, once the Fixed Term Parliaments Act is repealed, may well call an election in 2023. So, of course, we have no idea what's going to happen then. And if it does, is that going to be viewed as another sort of faux referendum or pseudo referendum on Scottish independence, as some people said the council elections were going to be and the Scottish Parliament elections were going to be? We just don't know.